Thank you for your attention. It is our pleasure to present moderator James Hogan, managing partner at Dentons Azerbaijan, with over two decades experience working in the region.
Well, thank you very much. I'm really very honored to start and introduce and moderate our next session, which is on public-private partnerships. I want to thank the organizers, of course, for taking the initiative to organize this very important session. I also want to thank those of you who've stayed in the audience all day, many of whom are just as jet-lagged as I am, and also given that Washington has some rather unusually warm weather today. I've frankly never seen it 78 degrees on March 1st in my entire life. But without further delay, what I propose to do is give a few introductory remarks about public-private partnerships, both in general and in relation to Azerbaijan, then go through the panel, let each of the panelists speak, give a short presentation on their respective angles to this topic, and then finish up with questions and answers, maybe a discussion. Perhaps having a lively discussion is a bit too high to aim for, but we'll do our best. So I think at the very outset, it's important to agree on a definition of public-private partnership. Now, for those of us in the legal field and those in banking and finance, and particularly in project finance practice, public-private partnership is very much a term of art. And I think the most widely accepted definition of public-private partnership is that proposed by the PPP Knowledge Lab, which defines PPP as a long-term contract between a private party and a government entity for providing a public asset or service to which the private party bears significant risk and management responsibility, and remuneration is linked to performance. So what, in the classical sense, what PPP is a business venture which is financed, put together, designed, usually built, and operated by a private company, private investor, in partnership with the government. And the management, this type of arrangement contrasts with typical public procurement law by which the government simply finances public works, signs a contract with the company, and both takes ownership and operation of the asset. Now, I have to say that unlike a number of neighboring countries, such as Russia, Ukraine, Kazakhstan, Azerbaijan has not actually developed a legal or institutional framework for public-private partnership in the classical sense. That doesn't mean, however, that we should simply adjourn our session and go out and enjoy the warm weather. What it does mean is that we should look to public-private partnership in a much broader sense. Specifically, Azerbaijan has a very long track record of encouraging and fostering and shaping the participation of private companies in public works projects. You find that in many aspects of existing Azerbaijani law, and it's certainly very much the attitude of the government officials in Azerbaijan, particularly now with the ongoing crisis. I guess you can say that PPP, even in its classical sense, can be duplicated to a very large degree based on existing Azerbaijani law. Azerbaijan, perhaps as its most salient feature of legislation, strongly supports freedom of contract principles. It's a principle that's guaranteed by the civil code, and given the nature of Azerbaijani legislation, which often is lacking in detail and is more framework and in orientation, often this means that public and private parties can agree and can define the terms of their particular project within the confines of their contract without interference of a lot of regulations or competing laws. It's also the case that there is a law on public procurement. There's a law on the protection of private foreign investment, which gives a lot of the protections that you would normally see in a bilateral investment treaty. There are indeed about 50 or so BITs, in effect, which also provide these protections. There is a law on pledges, a law on mortgages. PSAs themselves are a law unto themselves, quite literally, in that PSAs are contracts between public authorities and private oil companies, which exist as conflicts defining their relationship. But PSAs in Azerbaijan are also enacted into law. They're adopted by the parliament and have the force of law by their terms superseding all existing past and future laws to the contrary. It's also the case that in recent years, the government has tried to carve out certain mechanisms that give tax, customs, and other benefits to investors, both foreign and domestic. Among these, for many years, special economic zones were all the rage. They did not fully live up to their potential, but in the last 2 or 3 years, the industrial park regime, which give tax, customs, and other holidays for 7 years, do seem to have taken shape and are developing nicely, particularly the chemical industrial park, which is opened in Sumgait. Last year, the president issued a decree on investment promotion through the mechanism of investment promotion certificates, essentially allowing any entrepreneur to duplicate the benefits that it would have through an industrial park or similar project, but it can exist anywhere outside the confines of industrial parks based on proposals by such entrepreneurs. There's also a relatively new law on build, operate, transfer, which many of you know is a very important component of classical PPP-type projects. My good friend Kamil Valiyev will speak a bit about that. And finally, there's a very renewed privatization drive, including privatization through investment tenders, which provide many, many benefits and also a certain degree of commitment on the part of the investing body or company in the privatized asset. So without taking any more of the introduction, I'd like to introduce Kamil Valiyev, who is the managing partner of the Baku office of Baker, who is a partner in the Baku office of Baker McKenzie. He will speak a bit about PPP and the new BOT law.
Kamil. Thank you, Jim. And this is a very important topic, and I believe this is the continuation of the previous topic that we were just hearing several minutes ago about the reforms going on in Azerbaijan. And which are quite outstanding. And talking about private public-private partnership, I think there is a history of such a partnership between the public sector and private businesses in Azerbaijan, although not in the classical sense of its meaning that we will briefly I will talk about the law, the recent PPP law. But we know from the first years of the independence, the government of Azerbaijan and state-owned companies, they were entering into different corporations in the form of incorporated, unincorporated joint ventures with foreign companies as well as local investors. So, and we have quite an outstanding, let's say, experience of production sharing agreements, and I would agree with you that the production sharing agreements are a first, I would say, elements or first examples of PPP partnership in Azerbaijan. So we all see this a collaboration between the government, between the public sector and the private sector in Azerbaijan for last 20, 25 years. And this law, which came into force nearly a year ago, which was adopted by the Parliament of Azerbaijan in March 2016. This introduces a classical model of PPP partnership that that we know as lawyers and as bankers, we see it happening around the world. And the law itself, without going into the detail, and I hope we will have a chance to talk about this tomorrow morning, we'll have a separate session at our offices of Baker McKenzie DC office, where we will go into the detail of this arrangement. And I encourage all of you to come, and you're welcome to our office here in DC. When you read the law, you can see that the government of Azerbaijan is kind of trying to introduce a new model and introduce a new rules of cooperation between the private and the public sector. And what's interesting that the government is mindful about the needs of the private sector. For example, we often see this issue, and that relates to the joint ventures with the state enterprises. There's always a strong hand of the government, and there is some interest, the governmental and public interest, which come with such arrangements. But in this law, you can see that the government is mindful about of the needs, and mindful of the needs of the bankability of these projects. And I would like to add that the 2 months ago, the president of Azerbaijan issued a decree on the rules of the public-private partnership agreements, and that the process of the selection of private investors and projects. And these rules, they set specific mechanism of the selection of projects and investors. And what's important that, as you mentioned, that we have a public procurement law in Azerbaijan. Interestingly, this law will not apply to the PPP projects. So that means that these arrangements, this process of selection of investors, and the relationship between the government and the process of selection will be quite flexible within the rules provided in the decree of the president of Azerbaijan. On top of that, you can see the elements which encourage the attraction of foreign financing, or the financing through the different investment companies or investment banks. And the government realized that there should be some kind of flexibility provided to the private investors. So I believe these elements, which are embodied in the law itself and this decree, the recent decree, it shows that the willingness of the government. I think one of the concerns that we often see from the side of private businesses and foreign investors is how experienced is the government in the PPP sector. Mm-hmm. And I would agree that this classical approach to the PPP projects is quite new for Azerbaijan. And we may expect that during maybe upcoming years, there will be quite a strong capacity development at the level of government. But at the same time, I would like to refer to the PSA experience, which provides quite a good background for the government and shows the experience of the certain governmental entities in negotiating such a concession agreements with private investors. So briefly, I'm enthusiastic about this law, and I hope this will provide a solid basis for the future cooperation and attraction of foreign investment into Azerbaijan. But I think that the foreign investors, and specifically American companies, should be mindful that this is a new model in Azerbaijan, and maybe there will be a lot of interaction between the government and private investors in building up the relevant experience for the future successful projects, PPP projects.
Kamil, I think that's an excellent point. What's very important is not only to define certain incentives for private investors to engage in public work projects, but also the bankability of such projects are critical to obtain the financing. And although we have representatives of some of the largest banks in the world here, many of them are not so familiar with or necessarily comfortable with Azerbaijani law as it exists now. So perhaps the very, very long experience, now 26 years of PSAs, will enable any resistance to perhaps PPP law that would fill in the gaps to be enacted as a matter of attracting this new business model to the country. So the next person on our panel is Jennifer Sanford. Jennifer is the Director of International Trade and Energy Policy at Cisco. Jennifer, the floor is yours.
Thanks very much. And please excuse me, I have a cold, so I'll do my best to speak up and not sniffle too much. I wanted to start out by saying that I'm an international trade expert, and so we're going to come at this discussion about public-private partnerships a little bit differently, if I may. And I thought I'd start just introducing Cisco a bit. We're the worldwide leader in IP networking for enterprises, governments, and citizens around the world. We have helped to essentially get the internet up and running since the 1980s. And we've been in Azerbaijan since 2006. We have over 50 partners in Azerbaijan. And that's an important model for the company because we recognize that we can't do everything ourselves, that we need to partner with local firms to make sure that we're addressing local market needs. We did support the European Games in 2015. We supported the presidential election in 2013. Just to give you a sense for some of these large-scale projects that Cisco's been involved in. I would like to mention, President Aliyev's economic strategy and his goals to diversify the economy away from oil, increase exports, and to increase the competitiveness of the Azerbaijani economy. And in the Azerbaijan 2020 report, which is very, I would commend to you if you haven't read it, there's a very long section about ICT development, that is information communications technology development. Because we see ICT as the network is really a platform on which other sectors really jump off to improve their productivity. And I think that that's captured in this report because some of the goals are to expand ICT use, not just in the private sector, but by the government itself, and to provide services over the internet. Access to broadband, which is an important element. Once users start using the network, they demand faster and faster speeds. To deliver a secure broadband experience, which is vital so that people trust the interactions that they have on the internet. To develop human capital. And one thing I'll note there is that Cisco has a relationship with the Ministry of Education, because we have a networking academy program. We have 11 networking academies throughout Azerbaijan, that is with universities. And we have about 700 students per year. We've graduated just over 5,000 students. And the purpose of the Networking Academy is to help train people to become network engineers. Because we have electrical engineers, we have different types of engineers, and we needed some people who knew how to actually design and implement networks. So Cisco provides the curriculum and the products and, on which the course is taught. And we're in talks with the Ministry of Education to look at perhaps taking that into the secondary education sector as well. Now, the Ministry of Transport and Communications also has a strategy to help effectuate the broader policy that was discussed earlier. And there are five elements to this strategy: liberalization of telecom, increased investment in mobile, expanding digital payments, improving online services, and improving information services. And we think that all of these areas will go a long way toward building up the broadband and bringing things like the Internet of Things to Azerbaijan. In fact, we are partnered with Azerbaijan Post and Telecom to look at new business models using the network as a platform to provide citizen services, excuse me, through some of the ordinary course of government business. Can the relationship with the citizens be expanded through the use of mobile technologies in particular? So that's some interesting the work that we've got going that I suppose, Jim, I wouldn't characterize as a formal public-private partnership, but we do partner with governments in very meaningful ways throughout the world to talk about not just the market and how to evolve the market, but also what kind of policy environment will help to grow the market in a way that the government would like to see. There's a lot of headroom for growth in terms of ICT and network readiness and competitiveness in Azerbaijan. Azerbaijan's about sort of middle of the pack, if you will. And we think that through broadband deployment in particular, we can help to increase both the network readiness and the competitiveness of the country. For Cisco, we typically look at two sides of a coin when we talk with governments about how to increase broadband deployment and how to increase ICT usage. We often talk about supply side and demand side policy options. And as part of supply side, we look at things like increased competition and increased investment. And we're talking with the governments about things like IP convergence, that is that many legacy telecom networks have their own special technologies that they use, and we believe that the internet protocol is a way to unify the networks, as well as provide the kind of experience that users expect in terms of any device, anywhere, anytime. It's a seamless experience for the user. Things like streamlining licensing policies, attracting private investment in broadband, and competition for the international gateways. So I think I'll stop there. I have more to say, but I look forward to your questions.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Jennifer. It sounds like Cisco has had a very long and very deep history of cooperation with Azerbaijani public authorities. And it sounds from what you say that you're also playing a very big role in e-government and the kinds of initiatives of which the Asan centers are probably most emblematic that really, really stand out as truly homegrown, bottom-up initiatives in Azerbaijan that are perhaps among the most successful in streamlining red tape, bureaucracy, and bringing government services to the public. So the next person on our panel is Rovshan Najaf, who's the executive director of Azerbaijan Investment Company. And AIC, for those who don't know it, has existed for around 10 or 11 years.
2006.
12 years. It has certainly a unique role on the part of the investment climate in Azerbaijan. Essentially, AIC is a government-owned company, corporation, which has as its mission to help startup companies by enabling the government to take a minority stake in any kind of industry outside of the oil sector, I guess, and with the full intention and indeed obligation to divest itself once the company is up and running. So, Rovshan, please, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Jim. First of all, I would like to thank U.S. Azerbaijan Chamber of Commerce for organizing such a great event. USACC is playing a very important role in development of bilateral economic relations between Azerbaijan and the U.S., and they strongly contribute to the enhancement of cooperation between business communities of both countries, and they successfully act as a bridge between government entities and the private sector. And using this opportunity, I would like to thank all USACC staff for their efforts, and I would like to wish them success in all their future endeavors. It's a great privilege to be here today and present you opportunities for cooperation, PPP cooperation from perspective of AIC, which is not a classical term of PPP. In Azerbaijan, we do understand that without sustainable growth and progress, such words as achievement and success will have no meaning. Thus, we have to ensure that our economy is sustainably developing and it's changing, it's transforming. Our aim is to transform our economy into a knowledge-based, highly innovative, highly competitive economy. And one of the directions of this policy is to develop knowledge economy and attract investments to this sector. Azerbaijan Investment Company is a state-owned equity investment fund which is pursuing the objective of investing in knowledge economy together with local and foreign investors. Any foreign investor doing a business abroad is subject to certain risks and challenges. And having a reliable and experienced local partner surely helps to mitigate some of the risks and makes it much easier to decide to invest. And a local partner not only mitigates the risk, but also provides insight to the market opportunities, to the market, to the business communities and business networks. And in a sense, for an investor who is investing in a project abroad, to enjoy state support is certainly good, but having a state as a partner and equity investor in the project is even better. And proceeding from this point of view, the government of Azerbaijan established Azerbaijan Investment Company, AIC, in 2006. Our aim is just to bring new technologies and know-how to the country, to enable the new projects to be competitive, to be knowledge-based, and to be export-oriented. We also not only provide equity investments, but we also provide insights, we provide opportunities, business opportunities for our partners. We support conducting market research and drafting the business plans. And talking about the key principles of Azerbaijan Investment Company, we can invest in all projects, in all spheres except for oil and gas production, as Jim correctly mentioned. We can do both brownfield and greenfield, but meanwhile, our engagement is always based on minority shareholding, which means that we don't intervene to daily operations and management of the company, but only participate at strategic decision-making procedures and processes through representation of the board of the companies. And our investments are term equity investments. It means that after some period of time, when the company is successful operating and generating cash, we sell our shares, we sell our equity holdings. We can sell it through capital markets, for example, through IPOs, or we can sell it to strategic third investors, or we can sell it to existing shareholders based on our agreement. And by today, the total amount of the projects where Azerbaijan Investment Company has invested, it stands at over $1.1 billion. And these sectors cover agriculture, food processing, logistics, industry, including cement production, shipbuilding, and pharmaceuticals. I just would like to brief you on some of our projects which we have done. One of our flagship projects is Baku Shipyard, which is the most modern shipyard as a Caspian Sea. We have implemented this project together with state oil companies, SOCAR and Singaporean Keppel, which is also the manager of this project. In all our projects, we tend to bring only the state-of-the-art technology and management skills in order to enable our product to be competitive and to be high quality. And this project was inaugurated in 2012. The cost was around $470 million. And since its inauguration, the shipyard has already secured the contracts with a total amount more than half a billion dollars. And this only in a short period of time as they were acting. Another interesting project was the construction of a new cement plant We did it again with Wassim Lafarge, one of the global leaders in cement production, and the European Bank and European Bank for Reconstruction and Development. And this plant was based on dry kiln production technology, which is more environmental friendly and energy efficient. And one of our latest projects and milestones in our history is pharmaceutical projects, which we have started in Azerbaijan last year. One of our projects we are implementing together with one local and one foreign partner, and the aim is to establish pharmaceuticals industry in Azerbaijan, which is, because currently we are importing almost 100% of medicines to Azerbaijan. And our aim is to enable production of high quality products, and all our facilities will be GMP certified, which means that it will be of the highest standards. And besides the investments, equity investments, we also, starting from 2014, got a mandate to develop and manage so-called industrial estates. Industrial estates are special designated manufacturing compounds where AIC provides all infrastructure and facilities, also administrative and logistical support. And it means, in other words, we build facilities and we lease it on preferential terms to small and medium enterprises. And our aim is to enable business-friendly environment where industrial goods can be manufactured and relevant services can be provided. And finally, I would like to refer to Thomas Edison, the great American inventor, who said that the opportunity is missed by most people because it is dressed in overalls and looks like a work. Azerbaijan may be a small country tucked away in landlocked Caspian Sea, on the shores of the Caspian Sea, but put it on the regional perspective, where we have been holding a leading position in terms of economic power, stability, and competitiveness, and all this topped up with world-class infrastructure, which has been developed in the country in the last 10 years. This country stands out, offering masses of opportunities to explore. And we at Azerbaijan Investment Company are here for those partners, for those foreign investors, currently US-based investors, who are looking for a reliable partner to set up exploring these opportunities together. Thank you very much, Jim. It's briefly about AIC and our cooperation opportunities.
Thank you very much, Elshad. I think it's very important what you stress, that AIC is not simply a source of startup financing for new ventures, but having a government institution with a minority stake, so with non-interference, but having the government institution there to advocate on your behalf if you have difficulties with any layer or level of bureaucracy, if you need to resolve other types of issues, can be a very, very big advantage in a new investment. So thanks for that description. I'm a little curious. I wanted to ask you how the current low oil price environment and obviously the related financial situation in Azerbaijan has affected both the pipeline and level of projects that you see at AIC. Because on the one hand, obviously, the environment in Azerbaijan is all the more risk-averse given the economic situation. On the other hand, even investment in general globally is probably affected. So having a state institution on your side in a project might not be that much of a factor. What have you noticed in recent years?
Certainly, there has been some decrease in government expenditures on government projects, but since we are dealing mainly with commercial projects or with the private sector, actually we have seen increase in the number of the proposals we are receiving. And this is, first of all, related to the reforms that have been conducted in the country recently, which is makes it much more attractive now for foreign investors. Secondly, I talked about stability, and as you currently mentioned, there is now some decrease maybe in investments because of some political, economic, macroeconomic situation in the most of the countries. But when Azerbaijan, which is like stable country and which is offering investment opportunities and which is improves its business climate like always, And this makes it much more interesting for foreign investors currently to come to Azerbaijan, because they don't have a lot of choices if you compare with 10 years, 11 years ago, when there was a lot of new emerging markets where you can invest. But currently the situation with some of these emerging markets, I mean stability issues, are very important from investor point of view. And in this sense, we are seeing like increase, and we are glad to see it. For example, we started this pharmaceutical projects only last year, but we already signed two projects, two contracts. We are on the way to sign the third in recent one, or in the upcoming 1 or 2 week time. And it's also important to say that European leading pharmaceutical companies, they also are showing interest in Azerbaijan. It was discussed at the previous panel that Azerbaijan is a small country and what it can offer to companies to attract it to Azerbaijan. I think one of the answers is that most companies, they don't look only Azerbaijan as a local market. They look at our base where they can penetrate the neighboring countries, neighboring markets. And because of stability, it makes sense to invest in Azerbaijan, because having a stable base, it helps you to penetrate the neighboring countries' markets.
Thank you very much. I think it's a very good advertisement for investment in Azerbaijan. So the next panelist is Dr. Elshad Khanalibayli. Elshad is somebody I've known for quite a while. He is the head of international cooperation of the State Committee on Property Issues, in other words, the privatization agency for Azerbaijan. Having dealt with Elshad over the years, I have to say that I'm extremely comforted to be on this side of the table of negotiations than on the other side. Elshad is also the chair of the United Nations Intergovernmental Working Party on Land Administration. Elshad's going to talk to us about the new privatization drive, which is far different and in many ways far more aggressive than the initial drives that we saw in the very early 90s and then again in the late 90s. And also we'll talk a bit about his experiences and how the state role in privatization in partnership with private investors can show, once again, a literal example of public-private partnership. So, Elshad, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Jim. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. First, I shall take this opportunity just to congratulate you all on the occasion of the 25th anniversary of establishment of diplomatic and business relations between the United States and Azerbaijan. Talking of the privatization in Azerbaijan, first, if you don't mind, I would like to give some general overview on privatization, I mean, on the history of Azerbaijani privatization, and then to share my own thoughts about the visions and targets in the respect of privatization from the perspective of PPP, public-private partnership. Well, privatization of state property in Azerbaijan began in 1995. The most part of small and medium enterprises of retail trade, domestic services, public catering, motor transport, building industries, and other spheres were mainly privatized within the first state privatization program. Quite a number were sold in return for privatization vouchers, which had been distributed to the population free of charge. And during the validity of vouchers between 1997 and 2010, almost 1,500 enterprises were privatized at voucher auctions. Given that the first phase of privatization had been finished in Azerbaijan, now privatization is being carried out on the basis of the law on privatization of state property and the second state privatization program. This program provides for using of seven privatization methods, including case-by-case privatization, privatization at investment tenders, at specialized cash auctions, sales to employees on preferential terms, and so on. Today, the State Committee on Property Issues arranges the privatization of the most significant and large enterprises in the spheres of metallurgy, machine building, including oil engineering, light, food, and chemical industries, agriculture, production of construction materials, telecommunications and information technologies, and so on. And to provide necessary assistance in the preparation of enterprises for privatization, in many cases, we do bring in internationally recognized consultancy agencies such as Ernst & Young, KPMG, PricewaterhouseCoopers, Deloitte & Touche, Baker & McKenzie, BDO, and so on. And I wanted to note that 105 enterprises now have been privatized at investment tenders, and high volume of investments being made to the enterprises privatized at investment tenders. Among our investors, alongside with the domestic ones, we do have investors from Turkey, Russia, Switzerland, Russia, China, Finland, Germany, France, UK, USA, and other states. So I can give you some examples of the enterprises privatized at investment tenders. These are, for example, Garadagh Cement, then Baku Tobacco, Moscow Hotel, now known as the Baku Flame Towers, Azerbaijan Hotel, now the Baku Hilton Hotel, and Ganja Wine, and so on. So please note that foreign investors, whether natural and legal persons, have the same rights as Azerbaijani citizens to acquire state assets. And foreign investments rights are adequately protected by the law. So in regard to general stats, I'm proud to state that during this period, more than 300,000 workplaces have been created. More than 250,000 people have become shareholders. And almost 1.2 million of Azerbaijani citizens have reaped the benefit from the privatization. So furthermore, in order to increase the productive potential in the contemporary context, we attach particular importance to privatization, restructuring, and rehabilitation, as well as post-privatization support. And in this respect, according to the tax code and the presidential decree on regulation of debts of taxpayers' debts for tax, as of the 1st of January 2017, the interest calculated to for the late acquittance of debts for tax in respect of all the state-owned enterprises as well as joint stock companies with the state ownership share have been written off now. By the presidential decree on some measures related to acceleration of privatization and improvement of the efficiency of state property management, the acceleration of privatization is defined by the government and by the president himself as one of the most important dimensions for our economic policy. So, therefore, while establishing priorities to privatization, preference is given to the non-performing enterprises for the time being, which have the potential competitive edge potential in the region and which would be able to contribute to the social and economic development. So in order to kick off this process and to increase the efficiency of use of state property, and to improve state property management, the government has decided on some enterprises to remain state property for medium term for their further restructuring. On the other hand, our government has decided to arrange the privatization of 115 state-owned enterprises. And it published the list of 214 enterprises more in different spheres. These are the recreation zones, then kindergartens, children camps, the non-residential premises, factories, fish farms, and buildings and installations of different profiles. Moreover, the government, as I said, so decided, of course, yeah, but the government is paying specific attention to the acceleration of privatization. So this is not all, and there is more. We have developed a draft law, a new law on privatization of state property. This law is aiming at reducing the state expenses through gradual replacement of the state governing functions by state coordinating functions, by giving fresh impetus to the transparent and independent management, as well as strengthening the market economy by using new privatization methods, like, for example, the privatization of commercial tenders or at auctions without declaration of the reserved prices of enterprises and so on. Based on the best practices of developed countries, both the new draft law and the existing legislation allow investors to use the reliefs and exemptions while privatization of strategic enterprises and critical infrastructure. So information on auctions and investment tenders and procurement tenders, as well as on their results, is published in mass media and on the website of the State Committee on Property Issues and the digital privatization portal, of which the address is privatization.az, which was developed last year. The digital portal now is available in both Azerbaijani and English. And through this website, you can find answers to all your questions, starting with the most pressing one. Why Azerbaijan for investing, I mean, in respect of privatization? And of course, you can find there questions, answers to your questions regarding the legislation on customs, on tax, and perhaps best of all, you can find there on this website the detailed information on all the enterprises and critical infrastructure to be privatized. Based on the principles of public control and efficiency, and digital management system is widely used in the process of organization of auctions. And in order to simplify the participation of the people in privatization, as well as to provide transparency of the process, a few e-services is widely are being applied, and among them, just for instance, e-services on acceptance of applications for participation at auctions, on rental payment, on submission and collections of various reports, and so on. Well, of course, I could tell you a lot about privatization, and allowing the, although following the strict agenda of the session, just I tried to give you some brief information, just brief information about the privatization, and it's no coincidence that my speech on privatization is in the public-private partnership session, because both the organizers of this valuable event and we all do realize that privatization, wherever and whenever it is possible, is a PPP deal. So, dear U.S. investors, U.S. entrepreneurs, I do invite you to get acquainted with the privatization in Azerbaijan just by visiting our digital privatization portal, privatization.az, and of course, we would be happy if you contact us concerning our future cooperation. So we look forward to welcoming you to Azerbaijan, and thank you for your time.
Thank you very much, Elshad. I have a couple quick questions. First of all, just I was wondering if you could give a general figure or estimate of the number of enterprises that are currently up for privatization, that is either in terms of number or in terms of value. Do you have at least an approximate figure for?
Of course, I do have some figures, but I may be mistaken. Nevertheless, so more than about almost $2 billion U.S. dollars. Mm-hmm. Got the revenue for the state budget from the privatization. And the most interesting issue is that the 20% of the revenue is coming back to the State Committee on Property Issues for different objectives. And some of them is going to the pocket of the staff members. And uh-huh. That's why staff members, of course, here are interested just to privatize as much as possible. The more you privatize, the more you get. And on the other hand, yeah, but as I told, I hope that in the future, yeah, we'll get more good positive results in this sphere. But you know, we are not evaluating the level of privatization only just by figures. Mm-hmm. We can, for example, just sell the enterprise by symbolic price. For example, just one for $1. Mm-hmm. But we need the investor to make an investment there to the enterprise, so that the enterprise would be worked and would be renovated, and the new workplaces be opened there, and so on.
Well, I can understand why you're so enthusiastic now about privatization within your particular agency. Also, I wondered, based on your experience so far in the current privatization phase, what are the typical challenges or difficulties that you see in reaching agreement over the privatization of assets so far?
Well, before answering your question, I would like to know that the investors, both the local and the foreign investors, have the same rights in the participation in the privatization process. Nevertheless, yeah, we do have some challenges in not only in the privatization itself, but also in the implementation of this process from the technical point of view. For me, the biggest challenge is that the privatization of the enterprise is implemented separately without the privatization of land mm-hmm. under it. And the new draft law covers these issues. And you know, we are one of the few countries in the world that they are implementing the privatization separately, land mm-hmm. and enterprise or object or installation, critical infrastructure, no matter. And the new draft law, sorting out this issue. And in future, I think by the end of this year, this law will be approved, and in future, we will privatize the enterprise with its own land both together. This is, for me, as a specialist in this field, as a person who have been working for this in this sphere for more than 16, 17 years, this is the most significant and sensitive issue for me for privatization. The advantage is that the State Committee on Property Issues of Azerbaijan is one of the two unique organizations, authorities in the world, not only in CIS. The second one is the Belarusian State Committee on Property Issues, where the privatization that registration of real estate property rights, the cadastre of real estate, address registry, geodesy, mapping, cartography are implemented in one place, in one authority. It means that if you're an investor and if you would like to privatize something, and then just after getting the ownership on this property, so you can address only, you can apply only to the State Committee on Property Issues. It means something like this is a one-stop shop. Mm-hmm. And this is our advantage. Okay. And even, for example, in Russia, they have the separate organizations. Even they have three organizations which are dealing with the property issues, the privatization authority, the registration authority, cadastre authority. In UK, for example. But I'm telling this as because I know the real situation. I'm chair of, as you introduced me, the United Nations Intergovernmental Working Party on Land Administration. And I know this situation very well in these 206 countries. So, for example, in the UK, the registration and cadastre are the separate organizations. Mm-hmm. Of course, they don't have the organ authority which is directly dealing with privatization. There is no state assets to be privatized there, like in Azerbaijan. But in Belarus and in Azerbaijan, we have unique organizations from the point of view of property itself.
Thank you very much, Elshad. So in the remaining time, I'd like to go to our final panelist, who's Gary Litman. He's the Vice President for Global Initiatives of the U.S. Chamber of Commerce. And please, I know the organizers want you to take as much time as you want, as long as it's 5 minutes or less.
That will be easy. The U.S. Chamber of Commerce is an organization that's on the interface of public and private. That's our role in this country. We represent some 3 million companies in the United States, and I assure you that the majority of them would hate any idea of any partnership with our own government. And as our elections demonstrate, American companies, at least in the United States domestically, do not quite buy into the notion of partnership with a public authority, either American or a foreign one. And yet, I'm delighted to be here on this panel because times are changing and our members operate in every country, in every market, and we need to learn what is the future of public-private partnership going forward, including in emerging markets that have been growing relatively fast, even though they're small. We have to learn how it's done. We have to bring some of that experience back home, and we have to understand what our government will be doing, both in terms of supporting our businesses overseas and eventually bringing some of the same experience here to the United States. And also we have to deal with some public, foreign public authorities, including investment funds, sovereign wealth funds, who come to the United States, and they bring their own philosophy of how to do business with the private sector. We tend to think about those issues not so much in terms of public-private partnership, because the word partnership assumes a lot of trust that typically companies don't have for public authorities. It's doing business with government, either in some contractual relationship, procurement, privatization, or another form of engagement over long term. We've started cooperating with the World Bank 2 years ago on benchmarking public procurement and public-private partnership in over 100 countries. And the U.S. Chamber of Commerce rolled out the World Bank's report that benchmarked different regimes. Azerbaijan didn't score very highly, I must say, but it wasn't so much the transparency, it was the payment after the partnership has been established, which is not that unusual. You know, contractors always complain that they're not paid on time. That happens here, happens everywhere. But there's a lot of room for improvement and a lot of stuff for us to learn. We have more questions than answers about public-private partnership right now. because the public authorities in the United States and in many other countries are burdened with debt. Their contribution to joint projects is unclear in the future. If it's just money, if it's just demand, it's one thing. Those fat years may be behind us for some time. So what is the contribution of the public in the public-private partnership? And what is comfortable for American companies in particular in working with public authorities overseas? Those are difficult questions. I think lots of things are shifting in resource-rich countries like Azerbaijan. There was for many years an expectation that the government will keep spending, and we just need to make sure that we win some tenders in a competitive environment. Will that remain so? Will the government have to reassess what its contribution to doing business with the private sector is? And if you look at, you know, examples in other countries, I think the trend is towards a different kind of value proposition. What does the private sector really need from the government? You know, obviously demand, obviously financing where it's available, but increasingly it's stable regime, right, if you have the demand. But also sometimes intellectual contribution. Jennifer mentioned the internet. It's public-private partnership. The contribution of the public was the intellectual fundamental research, was the fundamentals of new businesses. We have a number of examples emerging in the United States that are similar in nature, in nuclear energy, in cybersecurity, in some environmental solutions. And my sense is that increasingly we'll be looking, American companies, I can't speak for others, American companies will be looking to governments for taking off some risk, but also providing not so much financial capital, but public services, be that education, R&D, you know, facilitation of payment procedures, reliable banking. It is the stuff that the private sector does not provide on its own, particularly not in emerging markets. Our sense is that we won't be looking to governments to spend on us as much as we want the governments to spend on other important values in the society that the private sector will then figure out how to monetize. Last point I would like to make, it's always difficult for many American companies to allocate sufficient management time to smaller markets. That's the reality of the economies of scale. So one question that is on our mind is, could you use some new public-private arrangements, partnerships on a multilateral basis? Can you envision more projects where, let's say, Azerbaijan is able to bring other public authorities from around the region, either through the Black Sea Development Bank or EBRD or some other forms, so that you could attract larger players to deal with you, and you could demonstrate that when you deal with several different authorities, it doesn't just complicate the process, that there are some positives there. If you could overcome that, I think you will see a lot more interest from American business, the high valuation of your assets, more interest in your privatization. But also we're learning. I think it's important to underscore that U.S. experience in public-private partnerships is sketchy, and the experience of our companies overseas is very, very uneven, and things are changing. Financing is changing, demand is changing, compliance requirements are changing, dealing with other stakeholders is becoming more and more complex. So it's a great opportunity for us to learn, engage in a conversation, and get a little bit smarter on PPPs.
Well, thank you very much. I think that's a very, very good summation of the kinds of issues we're looking at now. It's very clear that Azerbaijan is showing not only a very sincere desire to involve private participation in the public sector projects, but also is taking very concrete measures in which to make sure that that happens. I don't know if we have time for maybe one or two questions before we end the panel. I see two hands.
Resources.
Well, resources are going to be from diligence to advisors to bank lines and things like that. So that would be on the sponsor cost. So my question is just general percentage of where there's been a withdrawal of privatization or there's waiting out towards another time. I welcome anyone else who would like to comment on that.
So I'm not sure if we're going to quite understand. So, of course it depends. For example, I can give you some sample. In 2008, before the financial crisis, talking of the investment tenders, so we have arranged the privatization of 18 enterprises. All of these used to be strategic importance. And in 2009 and 10, it was a little bit fewer than it was in 2008. And of course, we do have, as a privatization stuff, we do have our own targets also. As I said earlier, the more you privatize, the more you get. But not only from the point of view of staff members, but also from the point of view of the whole economy, from the point of view of government. Because if I cannot privatize this enterprise this year, it means that, my target is enlarging. So it means that next year, it will be added to the enterprises which is scheduled to be privatized next year, and it will be added to this list. And of course, but it's within our interest just to privatize as much as possible. Nevertheless, of course, by the way, we do have some kinds of property which is prohibited, under the law, to be privatized, like in other countries. And for example, still so far, we cannot, we don't have any competence just to arrange the privatization of highways, or for example, cemeteries, or the production of electricity, the electricity obtaining process in total has in Azerbaijan. Three phases: this production, then transmission, and distribution, the sales. But the first part cannot be privatized. So, but the privatization in any country could not be how to say this, but it is not accepted by people, by society. On the same level, someone can agree with the results of privatization. Another, because this is something like the PPP transaction, and we do have two parties here: seller and buyer, purchaser. And of course, the seller would like to sell this as much as possible for the price, for more expensive, and the buyer would like to buy this for the cheaper price. But for example, just for 2017, we do have our own target, and as I said, so Now we do have 42 enterprises, if I'm not mistaken, but you can correct me. Mr. Elshad is the head of the Department for Strategic Privatization. So 42 or 45 enterprises to be privatized at investment tenders. So by the way, the investment tenders is the way of privatization where we need, the philosophy of this the type of privatization is the as much as investment and we pay more specific attention to their inputs. So how you can make this investment, in what and how, in for which terms.
Elshad, yep. We're moving into the next session. I'd like to get a very quick last question from Elshad. Well, I think what you're asking is that, or what you're saying is that, whereas in most areas, Azerbaijani law is extremely flexible, as long as there's a foreign element to the transaction, it's possible to opt for the application of the law decided by the parties. So you can have English law, New York law, whatever you want. But for real estate, it's so particular to Azerbaijan and its sovereignty that any disputes over title, let's say, to real estate will be necessarily decided before the Azerbaijani courts. I don't know, Kamil, if you have any comments with it. My own view is just that's the law, that's the rule, that's the way it is. And I can't say that foreign investors are necessarily 100% comfortable with that solution, but there are very, very few techniques you can use to mitigate the effect. Kamil, do you have?
Well, I would generally agree with what Jim said. Under our Code of Civil Procedure, the local courts have some exclusive jurisdiction over the real estate related disputes. And typically, we would advise, if that's comfortable for our clients, the foreign investors, that they would go with this issue. But let's say that the issue is not that, I would say there is not a straight line to address this issue. The title-related issues, definitely, they'll be they should be governed by the local laws, and the disputes will be should be resolved by local courts, but there is some room for addressing some contractual issues which come out of the land and real property related issues. So in that sense, the parties may try to govern certain aspects of the land related relationship by foreign law, let's say English law or maybe New York law. But the issue is that whether that will be enforced later on, if the issue is reviewed by in the local court, as well as if the parties decide to select the jurisdiction of a foreign arbitration, whether the arbitral award will be later on, enforced in Azerbaijan. So these are the risks that that foreign investors have to be informed about, and based on this risk, they may decide to go solely with the local courts, or they would like to add some elements of foreign arbitration and application of foreign law to some contractual relationship, which are not related with the title issues.
It's also possible that the foreign arbitral tribunal will decline jurisdiction over the claim based on their own reading of Azerbaijani law. So I'm sorry we have to conclude the session. We have a lot of very nervous organizers, but I'd like to give a hand to an excellent panel, and hope to see you in Azerbaijan.